set our work aside. We leave our cares behind on this day of Sabbath rest. On this your holy day, we come to give you praise on this day of Sabbath rest. Sabbath rest, holy rest. On the day he set aside, hallowed, blessed, and sanctified, Sabbath rest, holy rest. Sabbath rest, holy rest. Out of all the weak, the best we have come to be blessed on this day of Sabbath rest. Be
seated, please.
Happy Sabbath, church. And welcome to another Sabbath day, another week of refreshing, thanking the Lord for all the blessings of the week. And I know some of you are going to say, well, we had a hard week and we had this happen and we had that happen. But today, we're going to give praise, we're going to give glory, because we're here. And what happened throughout the week, the Lord took care of it. And what he didn't take care of throughout the week, he's going to take care of next week. Okay, so welcome. Do we have any first-time visitors with us today? Please stand. We have a gift for you. Any more? One more. Thank you for coming. There's one more here. One more here. We missed the lady on the back. Now, I will not forget our online visitors. We're very happy to have our shut-ins, our members who are unable to come out on Sabbath mornings to visit with us online. And also visitors. Now, if you are a visitor for the first time online today, I'm going to ask you to put a 1 in the chat. Send us your contact. We would love to get to know you better. We would love to pray for you and to encourage you along the way. We see in the house again, as always, Pastor and Sister Hazelwood. Welcome them. And for all our members, and my mom, Mama, happy Sabbath. She watches every week, so I have to tell Mama, happy Sabbath, Mama. May God bless you, and may God bless us all as we worship today in his sanctuary.
Praise the Lord, brethren. God has been good. We're here this morning, and that's a testament to his goodness. So I pray that we'll worship the Lord together today. I just have a few announcements that I wanted to highlight today. Just a reminder, today will be prayer and fasting. So right after service today, you are welcome to participate in the prayer and fasting. And just a reminder also for the, it's also a men's day of prayer today. So if you're a man in the house today, you are, a special invitation is extended to yourself to be a part of this prayer and fasting service. On April the 14th, we have a Sabbath school council meeting. April the 14th, and I'm seeing it's going to be on Zoom, and it will be for 12 noon. Also, elders meeting will be on April the 20th. In terms of the time, I'm sure that will be mentioned as we get closer to that date. And just a reminder that our children's church will be next week. So if you have a young one that needs to be in this program, please prepare for that. And so these are all the announcements I have for this morning. Please consult with your bulletin for any further details. Oh, I'm going to call upon Sister Shelley. She has some further announcements to share.
Happy Sabbath. I just quickly wanted to remind us that our paint night is tonight, and it will start right after AY. So I expect to see everyone out to support. And secondly, AY, in collaboration with the hospitality department, is soliciting toothpaste, toothbrush, soaps, deodorants, personal items, so that we can deliver every first Sabbath of the month to the homeless that are in downtown Brampton. Boxes are on the outside. Please bring them every week ongoing. The boxes will remain there. Thank you so much.
Good morning and happy Sabbath, brothers and sisters. You can do much better than that. Happy Sabbath, brothers and sisters. It's a joy to be alive, and it's a joy to be in the presence of God. You don't understand, but there are so many persons who would have loved to be in church today. But as I speak, they are in the hospital, some are on their dying beds. But here we are in God's house. Somebody ought to say amen. It's a joy to be back, brethren. I had a little break, was able to connect with my aged parents and my mother-in-law and father-in-law, and I'm happy that God is doing a mighty work. And I just want to take this opportunity to say a very big thank you. Thank you to my assistant pastor, Elder Price, and all the other elders for having provided leadership during my absence. Amen? This is a great church, and I'm happy that we have great leaders here. Come on, somebody say amen. And I want to personally say thanks to all of you for your prayers and your support. I could tell that the Brampton Church prayed for me during my absence. Amen? I brought back sunshine, brethren, and warmth. But I tell you, the moment I exited the airport, everything went. Everything went. I thought I had enough, but what you had here, what was here, or what is here, overpowered and took away all the warmth. But God is such a wonderful God. And I would love to hug everybody this morning, but I am unable to hug everybody. So I'm going to just ask you just to hug the person closest to you for me. Amen? And feel a little warmth. Feel a little of the sunshine, whatever is left. This is the place where everybody is somebody. Come on, somebody. And Christ is Lord of all. I want to, on behalf of our leadership team, say happy birthday to those who are celebrating or who would have celebrated your birthday during the course of this week. Do we have such celebrants here this morning? Anyone? Amen. Come on, could somebody say happy birthday? I believe it's one of our visitors. Am I right? Welcome and happy birthday to you. We hope and trust that you will enjoy good health and long life. Amen. What a place to enjoy your birthday. You could not have chosen a better place than the Brampton Sims, the Adventist Church. Amen? Then let me see those who celebrated your wedding anniversary. Anybody who celebrated? All right, nobody as yet. Okay, perhaps next year this time we will find someone or some folks celebrating. I just want to make mention, brothers and sisters, that our family life retreat is before us. Amen? And I would want to think that you see us here as a family, because we're a family. Are we together, brethren? I assist Sister Bev. I missed my brothers and sisters. And I said, but I've only been here for a few months, so why is this missing so intense? And I just couldn't wait to see you this morning. So I know I'm a part of a family here at Brampton. We are a happy family. And this family life retreat, brethren, is planned with all of us in mind. Come on, somebody say amen. And I want to commend Sister Price and Elder Price and the team for having organized and making sure that no one is excluded from the list. So just in case your name is not on the list, you need to speak with Sister Price, Elder Price, or any one of us. The aim is we want everyone. We would love everyone to be a part of it. Are we together, brethren? And as was announced last week, if you're having some challenges, speak with the team. What is this morning? Are we together, brethren? Yeah, talk with the team so that we can all be present at our family life retreat. Dr. Gordon is fired up and he's ready to go. And I want to make sure that whatever information he has to share, that all of us as a family will be able to benefit from it. Come on, somebody say amen. Amen. Then in a few weeks from now, we begin on the 4th of May. What will be happening at our church? The Ten Commandments series. Are we together, brethren? This is a special series that is planned with not just you in mind, but it is planned with your loved ones who are not yet members of the church, your friends who are not yet members of the church, your co-workers who are not yet members of the church. And so we are inviting you to prepare them. Are we together, brethren? You have gotten your Connecting Like Jesus invitation card. We ask you to supply the information so that we can from now start touching base and making sure that these individuals are properly prepared so that they can give their hearts to Jesus. Our elders will be the ones who will be leading the charge. Come on, somebody say amen. I don't like how you're sounding, brethren. Come on, thank you, sister Watt. Come on, brethren, say amen. Amen. Our elders will be leading the charge, and we're going to give our 100% support. It is not the elders' campaign or the leadership campaign. It is our campaign. Are we together, brethren? It is our campaign, and we're looking forward to your support. And so we want for you to keep that at the forefront of your minds. This morning we have a membership transfer out, our sister Nicolette Sutherland. This is the second reading. We did the first reading. And so at this time, do we have a motion from a member of the church that we release the membership of Sister Nicolette Sutherland to join membership with the Bolton Church? Is there a motion? It is moved. Is there a second? It is seconded. All right. All in favor say aye. Aye. Those who oppose say nay. There is no opposition. Thank you so very much. I think, right, there's no opposition. Yes. You know, when you hear one name, and you hear all in favor say aye, one little name cannot. Thank you so very much. We have also membership transfer in Sister Carol D. Maroro from Nairobi. Amen. We've been seeing her, and we are looking forward to our second reading where we will receive her into fellowship. Amen, brethren. We want to truly prepare our hearts for this very special service. Amen. You know, sometimes we come to services like these feeling like the least amongst the disciples. Sometimes we come feeling as if we are so unworthy. But the truth is, God is worthy. Amen? And he has made it possible that no matter how heavy the weight of sin is, we can come and lay all of our sins on Jesus, the spotless Lamb of God. I pray that as we share in this very special service today, that we will experience forgiveness, we will experience healing, we will experience transformation, and we will leave from this place with the assurance that Jesus loves us. This I know. God bless you.
Let us stand. Psalms 34 says, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continue to be in my mouth. My soul shall make her boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear thereof and be glad. O magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. The righteous cry, and the Lord heareth and delivereth them out of their troubles. The Lord is nigh unto them that are of a broken heart, and saveth such as be of a contrite spirit. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivereth them out of them all. Let us bless the name of the Lord as we worship him together.
Father, I pray that each and every one of us here have a heart sensitive to the prompting of the Holy Spirit. Let us not go through this service, this communion service, dear Father, like it is a dry formality. But rather, Lord, let our hearts be revivified. Let our hearts be restored. Let our hearts be confident, dear Father, and also assured of the great sacrifice that you made for us. And Lord, help us, dear Father, to be moved by your great love. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated.
So shall we stand for hymn of praise, hymn number 198, and can it be?
Praise the Lord. We are in the mode of worship today, and this morning we're going to be blessed with special music by Hearts of Praise. Amen.
hearts of praise ministering to all of us. Amen, church? Amen, amen. As I share the offertory with you this morning, our offering is for our local church budget. I just want to share a testimony prepared by Heather Thompson Day. She says, years ago, a mentor of mine encouraged me to take my relationship with God as seriously as I took my career. She saw me as a very driven person, but she instructed me to make sure I connected with God at the beginning of each day. That began with my habit of waking up before the sun rises around 5 a.m. to spend quiet time reading God's word and reflect on it through prayer. A little bit ago, my husband, my wife, and I... Right. It's good to put humor in everything, eh? And I noticed that our daughter taking out her Bible in the morning before getting ready for school. She found a corner in the living room for prayer. When my wife asked her why she was up so early, she said, "Mommy gets up early to speak to Jesus, and I want to do like Mommy." I was so struck by my daughter, it was and is my desire that my daughter develop a deep personal connection with Jesus. Whether this is your first time at church or your family built this church, if you look around, it's likely that you see someone whose spiritual journey with God you can learn from. Today's offering goes out to our local church budget. In order to keep the church ministries function, we depend on the generosity of all our members returning their faithful tithe and giving a liberal offering, which will go to financing our local church budget. And over the last 2 weeks, you've been seeing the thermometer that has been placed on the screen, might not be there today, but it reminds us of our own giving to support our local church budget. It is, giving must be intentional, because when we think about how the Lord has blessed us, when we think about just the ministry of the church in terms of its different outreach campaign, we think about just financing the utilities of a church and to keep our church doors open. It is through us that all of this is done. Of course, sometimes we have very little, but when we pray, the Lord will come to bless us. So this morning, our deacons will wait upon us for our tithes and our offerings. And as you give, remember, the greatest gift you could ever give is to give our hearts to the Lord. Right? Here are the ways in which we are able to return our tithes and our offerings.
Thank you for your generous giving. Here are four ways you can return your tithes and offering. In-person drop-off at our church, located at 37 Millstone Drive, on Wednesdays between 12 to 5 p.m. You may also drop off in person on Sabbaths if you are one of the worshipers attending the sanctuary in person on Sabbath. You can return your tithes and offering via e-transfer or online payment to Brampton Treasurer at AdventistOntario.org. Please be sure to specify where the funds should go, for example, tithes, and the dollar amount in the notes area provided. And you can go on the church's website at bramptonsda.org, click on the Giving tab, and fill out all of the required information.
It's time the deacons wait on us for the tithes and the offerings.
Thank you.
storehouse and prove me now, said the Lord of hosts, and I will pour you out a blessing. There shall not be room enough to receive.
Our loving Father and our Savior in heaven, we thank you, Lord, today for your extended grace upon our lives. Lord, we thank you, Lord, for the opportunity we have, Lord, where we could have earned. Lord, sometimes when we had little, Lord, you provided someone to provide for us. As we return our tithes and our offerings to you, we pray, O God, that we go to the furtherance of your cause. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Just a quick reminder that for the family life retreat, today is actually the deadline for persons to complete their registration.
Happy Sabbath, Church.
For brief praise and worship this morning, our first song will be I Gave My Life for Thee. Second, Have You Been to Jesus? And then third, I believe, and I believe all of us, we do believe. Amen?
I gave my life for thee, my prayer. Precious blood I shed, that thou might ransom me and quicken from the dead. I gave my life for thee. What hast thou given for me? I gave my life for thee. What hast thou given for me? My Father's house of light, my glory circle throne, I left for earthly night, for wandering sad and alone. I left it all for thee, as thou left all for me. I left it all for thee, as thou left all for me. I suffered much for thee, more than thy tongue can tell, of bitter agony, to rescue thee from hell. I've borne it all for thee. What hast thou borne for me? I've borne it all for thee. What hast thou borne for me?
Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in His praises? Or are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Let me see the garments that are stained with sin, and be washed in the blood of the Lamb. There's a fountain flowing for the soul unclean, oh, be washed in the blood of the Lamb. Are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless, are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? The blood in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb. Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb. Travel this earth-shifting sand that transcends all the reason of man. But the thing that matters the most in this world, they can never be held in our hands. I believe
anointing in the sanctuary.
sanctuary, there is a stillness in the atmosphere. Come and lay down the burdens you have carried, for in the sanctuary, God is here.
As we come before the Lord this morning, you turn to the back of your hymnals. There are some names there. We're asking for your prayers for these names in your daily devotions. There are numbers there that you can call them. Reach out to them. Let them know you're thinking about them. Let them know you're praying for them. At this time, I invite you to kneel where you are, if you can, as we come before the Lord in prayer. Our merciful and loving God, praise and glory to your most holy name. Great is your faithfulness, O Lord. Lord, you are merciful and just. And because you are merciful and just, we can come to your altar this morning. We're in the sanctuary, or at home, or wherever we are, we can come before you. Lord, we come to the fountain filled with Emmanuel's blood, that you may cleanse us and forgive us of all our sins. Oh Lord, forgive us that we may be worthy to be called your sons and daughter. Father God, we are thankful. Thankful for this is the day that you have made, the day we all come together to worship and to fellowship. Father God, we are thankful for your blessing. We are thankful for your mercy. We are thankful, O God, for the difficult times you have brought us through. We are thankful for your healing. Father God, I pray now for those among us who may lack faith, that you may increase our faith. I pray for those that may be troubled with anxiety, that you may increase our trust. Father God, I pray for each and every person, Lord, that may be physically disabled or mentally unstable, that you may heal them, O Father God. Father God, I look at the back of the bulletin, Lord, there's some prayer list here, Lord, that I'd like to mention. For those who are suffering war-torn countries, oh God, I pray, oh God, you know, there are evil men who seek to destroy humankind. So I pray, oh God, that you'll send your angels to be with those that are suffering. I pray for families who have lost loved ones, oh Father God, that you may comfort them now. Pray for our seniors, Lord. Continue to strengthen them, encourage them. For those who are recovering from illnesses, oh God, continue to strengthen them also. For the shut-ins, Lord, they would like to be out to worship, but Lord, because of their physical impairment, Lord, they're unable to, so I pray that you'll bless them and be with them. Pray for those who are in the hospital, oh God. Some may be critical. Some may be going through rehab. I pray that you'll continue to bless them and strengthen them also. For those who are unemployed, Lord, I pray that you, oh God, help them to find work. For the asylum seekers, I pray, they may have left their country because of persecution, our economic situation, oh God, I pray, oh Lord, that you'll bless them. For those who are alone, Lord, be with them and send them some companions, Lord. Pray for those that are living in a nursing home. Bless the nurses who are looking after them, Lord. Father God, there's a prayer box here with names and requests in it, Lord. You know each and every desire, every situation, everything that's written down. I pray, oh God, that you'll answer according to your will. Father God, this morning some of us went out in the community, downtown Brampton, and we witnessed, oh God, people living in tents, people living in desolate situations. Lord, we cannot believe this is happening in our town, but Lord, it is. A lot of us may be living in our comfort, Lord, but there are people out there who are suffering, who can't afford rent, who can't even afford the very food to eat, Lord. I pray as a church, Lord, we may do more to reach and to help these individuals. Father God, this world, you know, as you look down, Lord, you see what's going on. And it's not too long before you will come back, Lord. Father God, this morning you have put a message on, you've called a young man, and you've put a message on his heart. And as he come to give us the word, Lord, I pray that as he do so, Lord, you strengthen him, and he will do so in confidence. And I pray as we listen to the words, oh God, we may be changed to better, Lord. And Lord, as we, the communion table is set, and we're about to partake of the emblems, Lord, help us, oh God, to remember the sacrifice that the Lord Jesus made for us, that we may not do so in vain. But Lord, as we partake of it, oh God, we may be changed and be saved. Father God, we just want to thank you, oh God, for all our visitors who are here with us this morning. Continue to bless them. Thank you, oh God, for your mercy and your love. And we thank you for Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Good morning, church. Happy Sabbath. The scripture reading today will be coming from Hebrews chapter 9, verse 14 through 17. That's Hebrews chapter 9, verse 14 through 17. And it reads, how much more? Can we all stand, please? Sorry. And I'll read in your hearing. And it said, how much more shall the blood of Christ, through the eternal Spirit, offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience for dead works do serve the living God. And for this cause, he is the mediator of the New Testament, that by means of death, for the redemption of the transgressions that were under the First Testament, that they which are called might receive the promise of eternal inheritance. For where a testament is, there must also be necessity be the death of a testator. For a testament is of force after men are dead. Otherwise, it is of no strength at all while the testator liveth. Here, read it into God's holy word. You may be seated.
Preach the word. Preach the word. In season and out of season. The time has come for the spoken word, and it's my responsibility to introduce the speaker. And we know the speaker for today is no stranger to us. God have used him in a mighty way before, and we know today is no exception. So, our assistant pastor, Pastor Samuel Appiah. And we know God has laid a word on his heart to share. So as he comes to share, we just want to ask you to lift him up in prayer, that God will use him again in a mighty way. But before you hear from our speaker, again, we will hear Art of Praise. As they bless us before, they will bless us again. Okay.
For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you a hope and a future. Then you'll come upon me and come and pray to me, and I'll listen to you. You seek me and find me when you seek me with a whole heart.
Yeah.
Well, let's praise the Lord again for hearts of praise. We could do better than that. Amen. Amen. You know, I find that our walk with God can sometimes get a bit hazy. It can get a bit hazy because there's a lot of things that we do over and over again, and we tend to just acclimate ourselves to it and desensitize ourselves to it. And, you know, what as a result of that desensitization, sometimes we don't really have a clear conception of who we are or where we stand with God. I'm reminded of a story of this woman who thought her husband was going deaf. And so she went to the doctor and she said, "You know, doctor, I think my husband's going deaf." She said, "How do you know?" Well, she said, "Anytime I call for him, this guy never hears me, never responds." Sounds like there's some people in the congregation who think their husbands are going deaf in here. Well, the doctor says, "Okay, I have a bright idea. How about you stand 30 feet away and you yell at him, see if he responds. If that doesn't work, stand 25 feet. If that doesn't work, stand 20 feet. If that doesn't work, go get progressively closer till he finally says something or responds." And so she went home in haste to try out the doctor's idea. So she had just cooked and she said, "Honey," at 30 feet away, "dinner is ready." "Oh, sorry," he said, "honey, what would you like for dinner?" And he didn't say anything. So he goes 25 feet, "Honey, what would you like for dinner?" And he didn't say anything. So she gets progressively closer, and now she's at about 10 feet away. "Honey, what would you like for dinner?" He still doesn't respond. As you imagine, this is frustrating for her. And so she gets so close, literally she's just 1 foot behind him. And she says again, "Honey, what would you like for dinner?" For the 15th time. And he turns to her and he says, "All right. For the 15th time, I said lasagna." She had a deaf one. And oftentimes in our spiritual walk, we're like that with God. We might be frustrated and think that he doesn't hear us when we're not the ones listening. And so I pray that as we go through this communion service that we do not do that today. Now let us go to Hebrews chapter 9. Hebrews chapter 9 and verse 14. Hebrews chapter 9 and verse 14. And as you're rolling there, I will pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this opportunity where we could hear a word from you. We ask that you bless it in Jesus' name. Amen. Hebrews chapter 9, starting at verse 14. It says, "How much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God? And for this cause he is made a mediator of the what? New Testament, by means of death, for the redemption of the transgressions that were under the first testament. They which are called might receive the promise of what? An eternal inheritance. For where there is a testament, there must also of necessity be the death of a what? For a testament is of no force after men die. Otherwise, it is of no strength while he liveth." The interesting thing about this chapter is that the Apostle Paul begins by juxtaposing the methods or the nature of the Old Testament and the New Testament. He begins by discussing how in the Old Testament, in order for you to get forgiveness of your sins, one would need to take an animal and sacrifice it. And that there was an earthly temple set up so that one could be absolved of their sins. But then he points to the fact that in the New Testament, there is a better way, a more eternal system, a system in which there is one sacrifice made for mankind, and that sacrifice is Jesus. Amen, church. And that there is one mediator who is also Jesus, and that forgiveness of sin is just a prayer away. He goes back and forth, making this comparison, this juxtaposition between the benefits or what existed in the old and the benefits of the new. And then he comes to this place in the scripture where he uses this jargon, a jargon that it's very easy for us to overlook. He uses this word testament in conjunction with the fact that there needs to be a testator. And I want to tell you this morning that this verbiage that is used here is not any ordinary verbiage. It actually has legal connotation. As a matter of fact, you've probably heard, if your family has been so prudent to do estate planning, that this is the reading of their last will and what? Testament. And that phrase, last will and testament, is actually quite redundant. It literally means the same thing. Will can mean testament, and testament means will. It is like saying hallelujah twice. Say hallelujah twice for me. It's redundant. And so here it is. He is talking about the fact that where there is a testament, it necessitates that there should be a testator. Now, one might ask, what is a testator? Well, if I write a will, then that means that somebody would have had to write the will, no? The will would have to belong to somebody. And so the testator is the person who wrote the will. Please do not lose this point. Because here we find something more significant about the death of Jesus Christ. Is that he has been so prudent to do estate planning for his children. Come on, somebody. You see, the death of Jesus Christ was not just something that took place 2,000 years ago. It's not just something that absolves us of our sin when we repent. But also, it secured our eternal inheritance. Do I have an amen, somebody? You see, the Old Testament, they had a promise of temporal estate or a temporal inheritance. God promised them that they would have the land of Canaan flowing with what? But we are promised a what? Heavenly Canaan. See, while here on earth we are promised that, you know, at times we may feel peace and joy, but oftentimes it's interspersed with conflict and strife. But in heaven we know that in God's presence there's fullness of joy, and at his right hand there are pleasures forevermore. You see, on earth, while we experience a little bit, is that right? Of our temporal inheritance, God has something more lasting for us in heaven. But it begs the question, if God has this eternal inheritance for us, who are the beneficiaries? Who are the beneficiaries? Who is going to inherit this property? Who? He said me. Sister said me. Amen. I was saw a joke where there was a young man who suffered a heart attack, and he went into the hospital. And while there in the hospital, they got news that his rich uncle had passed away. But everybody had resolved, all the nurses, all the family that was nearby said, listen, we can't tell him anything that will excite him. And so he got $10 million from his rich uncle who just passed away. And obviously the news that the uncle passed away is one thing, but also the $10 million is another thing. And so they're like, how can we break the news to him? So they got the pastor. And the pastor used tact. And as he's there, he gradually built up and warmed him and massaged him verbally with warm butter. Till he said, listen, your uncle, rich uncle, passed away and left you $10 million, an amazing sum. Then he asked him, what do you plan to do with it? Right? He wants to lean into it. What do you plan to do with it? He said, I plan to give half to the church. You know the pastor suffered a heart attack and passed away? You like that one? You see, all of us are intended to receive a grand inheritance. But at the same time, how we conduct ourselves, our relationship with the one who is going to bequeath us with this inheritance is vitally important. I'm sure many of you have seen, maybe in movies or experienced in real life, where everybody is gathered around to hear what is going to happen. What is the result of the reading of the last will and testament? And some are elated to find out that they received a handsome portion, a generous amount, life-changing amounts. However, some get nothing. And they're bitterly disappointed. Them vex. And some are vexed. They have the sense of entitlement that they should have received something. But somehow, the testator saw that this person was unfit to receive part of the inheritance. My appeal to you today, as we go through this communion service, is ask yourself, if he was to read his last will and testament today, would you receive your eternal inheritance? Would your name be called? Would he say, Brother Aaron, here in my house are many mansions? Or would he say, depart from me, I never knew you? Brethren, as we go through this communion service, I ask of you to do soul searching. And if you are not completely where you should be with God today, that is okay. There is still time, while time lingers, to make that decided change. If it is your desire to make that change, stand to your feet this time. Let us pray. Loving Father in heaven, we're so thankful that you are an awesome God, that you're a God who not just died for us out of extreme, unhuman love, but you also secured an inheritance for us, showing, dear Father, that you want us to walk on the streets of gold with you. That, Lord, while we may be struggling down here to pay mortgages, dear Father, you have a place that is mortgage-free. Lord, you also have given us the opportunity, dear Father, to experience happiness and joy and all sorts of ranges of human emotion here. But Lord, we have also experienced affliction and suffering. So Lord, help us to fix our minds on the fact, dear Father, that you have something great in store for us. That Lord, you're going to wipe every tear from our eye. That you're going to comfort us, dear Father. And that, Lord, we won't experience the troubles of this earth anymore. But I pray, dear Father, that as your people have stood here in response to this message, I ask that they take this very seriously, that they make their calling and election sure, that they, dear Father, will be able to inherit, dear Father, what you have intended to allot them. This I pray in Jesus' name. You may be seated.
Let the church say amen. Amen. We will now prepare ourselves for the ordinance of foot washing. Let me just share with the church, with our visitors, that in the Seventh-day Adventist Church, we practice open communion service. And so if you desire to share in the communion service, you are a Christian from another denomination, and you desire to share in our communion service here, you are free to do so. Amen? We have reserved the space downstairs for the washing of feet. For those who are physically challenged, the mother's room is reserved for you. Amen? And so you don't have to go all that way downstairs. If you have some physical issues, then preparation is made with you in mind. And so we encourage those individuals to use the mother's room. Let me invite the congregation to stand at the singing of the second stanza of the hymn, "I Will Follow Thee, My Savior." Number 623, I invite all of us to move expeditiously. We invite our old timers, those of us who've been members of the church. We have some newly baptized members in our church. They are still fairly new. We invite the experienced ones to partner with the new ones so that we can expose them and help to cement them as we engage in this ordinance of foot washing. Shall we sing at the second stanza? We will move towards the downstairs for the foot washing. Let's go.
I will follow thee, my Savior, wheresoever my lot may be.
Where thou goest?
Where thou goest, I will follow.
Yes, my Lord.
Yes, my Lord, I'll follow thee.
I will follow thee.
I will follow thee, my Savior.
Thou didst shed
thy blood for me.
And though all men should forsake thee.
By thy grace, I'll follow thee.
Though the road be rough and thorny,
reckless as the foaming sea, thou hast trod this way before me, and I'll gladly follow thee. I will follow thee, my Savior. Thou didst shed thy blood for me. And though all men should forsake thee, by thy grace I'll follow thee. Though I meet with tribulations, surely tempted though I be, I remain was tempted and rejoiced to follow thee. I will follow thee, my Savior. Thou didst shed thy blood for me. And though all men should forsake me, by thy grace I'll follow.
Thank you.
I don't know how many persons remained in the main sanctuary while we were engaged in the ordinance of foot washing, but we counted 111 persons who will be participating in the communion service today, and we say to God be the glory. Can you imagine if all 111 of us are present and accounted when it's time for us to claim our eternal inheritance? What a joy that will be. Come on, somebody say amen. We appreciate what God has done for us through Jesus Christ. He's the one who would have made this possible. Every one of us, regardless of our challenges, regardless of where we would have been, we are all invited to feast at the table of grace. I feel honored that it is not men who would have extended the invitation. It is Jesus Christ himself. So I am happy that when he was on the cross, you and I were on his mind. It's against this background that we welcome you to this communion service. And we pray that as we participate, as we share in the experience, that we will truly experience what heaven, a little of what heaven will be like. So that we will purpose in our hearts that when the roll is called up yonder, we will all be present. Welcome to God's table of grace. At this time, we will invite the congregation to remain seated as we will sing number 317, Lead Me to Calvary.
Glory be, lest I forget thy thorn crown brow, lead me to Calvary. Lest I forget Gethsemane, lest I forget thine agony, lest I forget thy love for me. Lead me to Calvary. Show me the tomb where thou wast laid, tenderly mourned and wept. Angels in robes of light array guarded thee whilst thou slept. Lest I forget Gethsemane, lest I forget thine agony, lest I forget thy love for me, lead me to Calvary. Let me like Mary through the gloom come with a gift to show me now the empty tomb. Lead me to Calvary. Lest I forget Gethsemane. Lest I forget thine agony. Lest I forget thy love for me. Lead me to Calvary. To bear daily my cross for thee, even thy cup of grief to share, thou hast borne all for me,
my Lord.
Lest I forget Gethsemane, lest I forget thine agony, lest I
and break it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body."
And he took the cup and gave thanks, and he gave it to them, saying, "Drink ye all of it." For this is my blood of the New Testament, which I shed for many for the remission of sin. But I say unto you, I will not drink henceforth of this fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom.
Let's all stand, please, with our heads bowed. Loving God and merciful Father in heaven, it is indeed a privilege and a pleasure, Lord, to come once again at this communion table. Lord, remembering the great sacrifice that you have made for us on the cross of Calvary. But right now, Lord, we are not standing in the shadow of the cross, O God, but we are living in the saving light and the power of your grace. So, Father, Lord, we ask that for your blessings upon this bread at this moment. May it nourish our souls, Lord. May we be satisfied to the point of going out and letting our light shine, that we will be light in this dark world and salt to this earth, O God. You promised us, Lord, you said that as often as we eat this bread, we do it until you come. So, Father God, with great anticipation, we partake of this bread today, and with great expectation, Lord, we await your return, where we can eat with you in your kingdom, in the earth made new. This is my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Amen.
And as we continue to pray, Heavenly Father, we recognize your sacrifice. What love. As we look at the cross, Lord, we see the extent or the magnitude of your love. Your broken body, Heavenly Father, we just prayed for. Lord, the emblem of the bread, Lord, that will be partaken of momentarily. In addition to that, Lord, we recognize and we appreciate, Lord, for your spilled blood, the wine, the emblem that symbolizes the spilled blood. Oh, Heavenly Father, you sacrifice so much for us, for the entire human race. We thank you so much, Heavenly Father. Help us to understand such a significance that this service is indeed a solemn one, Lord, so the sacredness of the service will be such, Heavenly Father, that we internalize this experience, that we partake, Lord, of these emblems. Lord, we reflect on what Christ has done for us. So we thank you once again, Heavenly Father, for your continued watch, care, and protection. We do this in remembrance of you as we partake of the emblem symbolizes your spirit, blood, the wine, Heavenly Father. We thank you for your sacrifice and help it to be meaningful to us going forward. We pray these things now for Christ's sake. Amen. Amen. Amen.
You may be seated. We invite the congregation to turn to the hymn number 271, "Break Thou the Bread of Life, Dear Lord, to Me."
Shall all bandages
Lord, we continue to sing number 184, Jesus Paid It All.
Savior say, thy strength indeed is small. Trial of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin has left the crimson stain.
Sing it like you mean it, Jesus.
Jesus paid it all.
Oh,
all to him I owe.
Sin and laughter.
Sin has left the crimson stain. He washed it white as snow.
And God's people say amen. We continue to sing number 307, I am coming to the cross. Number 307.
Friends and time and earthly store.
trust in.
Say praise the Lord. Number 322, nothing between my soul and the Savior.
Nothing
between my soul and the Savior, so that his blessed face may be seen.
Nothing
preventing the least of his favor. Keep the way clear, let nothing.
Watching with prayer.
Watching with prayer.
And much self-denial. Triumph at last.
Triumph at last with nothing between.
Nothing
between my soul and the Savior. So that his blessed face. Of his favor, keep the way clear, let nothing be between.
Amen. I don't know about you, but I want nothing to stand between my soul and my Savior. Come on, somebody say amen.
Amen.
I'm really, really happy that even while we're sitting there, we can search through our own life. And if we sense that there's something that is out of place, something that is not where, not right, something that is not where it ought to be, we can talk to God right there. Come on, somebody. And he will fix it for you. We will continue to sing from our church hymnal number 155. When I survey the wondrous cross.
When I survey the wondrous cross.
hand, sir, could you just indicate by the uplifting of your right hand? Perhaps you might have been overlooked. You weren't served. Everyone has been served. Emblems, which represent the broken body and the spilled blood. One songwriter says, from his side there, there's a fountain flowing from his side, and it was flowing deep and wide, which means that you can't outlove God. You can't be too deep in your state where he cannot reach you. If you are way down there, God's love can reach you wherever you are. Won't you say that?
Amen.
The good thing about God's love, that when he finds you, he doesn't leave you where he finds you, but he places you where you ought to be.
Amen.
So I pray that as we partake of this emblem, and we're not going to partake of both emblems at the same time, amen? We're going to partake of the bread, and then we will come again and invite you to partake of the wine. That's all right? And so at this time, those of us at the head table will be seated, and together we will prayerfully partake of this emblem which represents the broken body. And I pray that the Lord will truly, you know, sometimes to get us where we ought to be, he has to do some breaking and molding and reshaping. But I pray that the Lord will just fix us where he wants us to be as we partake. That is still filled with blood. So that sinners, no matter how you are stained with sin today, before you leave here, you can lose all your guilty stains.
Yes.
One songwriter says, "'Tis the blood that gives me strength from day to day." Come on, somebody.
Yes.
And it will never, never lose its.
as we partake of this emblem which represents his spirit now, that wherever sin is, that we will truly be and thoroughly be cleansed of it all, that we will reflect the love and the character of Jesus Christ. We will now prayerfully partake of this emblem, and I pray that our sins. Amen.
Amen.
The dying thief rejoiced to see.
From the grave is raised.
some from the grave.
Amen. We will sing number 183. I will sing of Jesus' love. Let's go together. Oh, I will sing. I will sing. Of Jesus, love, sing of him. Oh, first love, oh, for he left. Come on, church, sing. Bright words, and died on Calvary. I will sing, oh, I will sing of Jesus. Death of love, divine earth or heaven, can never know how that sin, as dark as water, can be made as white as snow. Oh, I will sing of Jesus' love. Such love bestow, Lord, I hold, my heart is one. Help me now, my love to show. Praise the Lord, oh, I will sing
of Jesus. Endless praise, my heart shall give. He has done that.
Lord, lift your hands and say, thank you, Jesus. He has died that you and I might live. I want to claim that blessing of eternal life today. Won't you say amen? Amen. We're going to take just about 4 testimonies. I believe that since the last communion service, God would have done something miraculous in your life. And you wish to share that experience with us. Now we're going to ask you to make it brief. Amen?
Amen.
Maximum 2 minutes. That's all right. Maximum. I know that God has been so good to us. It would take us the entire rest of day and the rest of the week and perhaps the rest of the year to talk about God's goodness. Amen? But we're going to ask you just to put it all in one little capsule, amen, and just share with us what God has done for you.
Amen.
Amen. The mics are positioned, and so we will only be able to take the first of 4 persons.
I just want to praise the Lord because God has been good to me. I'm alive.
Amen. Amen. Even without a mic, we could hear it so loud. Amen. And that's it, regimen. God has been good to us. We can shout it. Amen. Amen. Do we have somebody else?
Yes. I had a little incident yesterday at home. I had a little slip in the washroom. I had an accident, and so I was cleaning up and things. So I thought the tile was dry enough, so I slipped in the washroom. Went down hard. But I got up a little dizzy, but I thought I was here to just go. So I said, no, I don't want to go this way, Lord. I think I make it right with everybody who have made it wrong with me. I apologize, but I don't know if I miss anything, anybody. So I said it in my mind, Father, please forgive me who I don't remember. And, you know, so you don't know. If you and somebody have something, don't go to bed with it, because you don't know if you will get up the next morning, right? So I really thank God for that little mishap, and it wake me up too, because I live alone, right? So anything can happen. So that's all I have to share for now. Thank you. If I do anybody anything, please forgive me too, right? Because I ask the Lord to what I don't remember to take care of it, right? We are all sinners, you know that, right? So we have to just do our best, right? Amen. Thank you.
Amen. And just before we take Sister Gordon, I listened to Brother Michael, and yes, some of us we chuckled and we laughed a little, but the communion service is designed that even before you partake, if you have something in your heart carrying against a brother or a sister, we should be able to settle that. And then come to the table. Because when we leave the table, it should be nothing between. Are we together, brothers and sisters? And so I pray, God, that whatever we have to settle with each other, if there is anything that needs to be settled, that before we leave here, we can walk from this place with a free heart and with a free conscience. Come on, somebody say amen. Amen. Sister Gordon, could we assist her with the mic, please?
I just want to say thanks be to God. As for man, I should not be here today. But God says not so. I was unconscious for 2 days, knowing not nothing. My eyes was closed. I can only say what somebody else told me, because I wasn't aware of it. But by the grace of God, He spared my life. I don't know why, but He knows why. But I'm asking Him that if there is anything between me and my Savior, I'm asking Him to pardon and forgive me, and may I make it right before I depart this life. This is what I have to say.
Let God's people say amen.
Amen.
She is a miracle.
Amen.
She's a miracle. And I believe that God still works miracles. Amen?
Amen.
Thank you, Sister Gordon. We take one last one.
Okay, as I bring the mic back.
Yes.
I can sing the wondrous love of Jesus. Last communion, I was handed up there. Praise God. Today, I'm not all there yet, but I can get up there. One step, not 2 feet on one step, but one step at a time.
Amen.
I've been back at work now 2 weeks, modified, of course, half shifts 2 days per week. But you know what, brethren? I'm a walking testimony. And we take a lot of things for granted. And sometimes God brings us to a place where we can't take Him for granted anymore. So I give Him praise, and I encourage all of us, keep praying for each other. We pray for each other. I pray for you. You pray for me. And give God the praise and the glory. It's not time to sit in church with sad faces. He's done so much for us. And when I hear of other people getting knocked down, or sometimes the boys come home and they tell me what they had to deal with, all I can say is, thank you, Jesus. Because that could have been me. So I give God praise. I give Him thanks. Time is too short to tell of His wondrous love. Amen.
Amen. Amen. And amen. It soon be done. When troubles and trials, when I get home on the other side,
One songwriter says, I'm going to shake my hand with the elders. And I'm going to tell all the people, good morning. But I'm going to sit down beside my Jesus. I'm going to sit down and I'm going to rest a little while. It'll soon be done. Can you imagine if all of us, 111 of us, are seen in that number? We have to be there, brethren. We can't allow for anything or anyone to steal our joy. You won't have the perfect excuse as to why you are missing, if you're missing. By God's grace, we have to be there. We must be there. And the good thing about it is that when we get there, it won't be Pastor Appiah, Elder Bentley, or Pastor Hazelwood, or Elder Pine, or any one of us who will be serving. Can you imagine when Jesus comes over by the fisher, looks you in your eyes, and he said, welcome home, my child. The table is already spread. The chairs are already positioned. And Brother Woolery, whether you believe it, yes or no, you are seated right up front. Your space is reserved, Sister Shelley, with your name written on it. By God's grace, Sister Reynolds, I want to be there. I want to be seated in my chair. I want to be able to hear my new name. One songwriter says there's a new name written down in glory. And it's mine. Oh yes, it's mine. I challenge you. We are one communion closer to the coming of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Jesus made the promise to his disciples. He said, listen, at the last communion, he said, guys, this might be the last one down here, but I make a promise. I will do it new with you in my Father's kingdom. That promise is for every one of us. I'm happy that it is not the board of elders or a special committee or at a members' meeting, a decision will be made as to who gets there. Your provision is already taken care of by Jesus Christ. All you have to do is to be there. Amen. So if you have to hop to get there, just get there. If you have to step past some people to get there, just get there. Because when you get there, what a day that will be. Amen, somebody? So with this kind of hope and desire and expectation, I want you to turn to the person beside you and say to that person, by God's grace, I will be there. Can you imagine, church? I can't wait for that day to come. If you wanted to give up, you should have given up a long, long time ago. Listen, it's too late to give up now. Hold on. Weeping may endure, but for a night. But joy comes in the morning. It soon be done. The last communion service that Jesus had with his disciples, it did not end with a prayer. The Bible said that they sang a hymn and they went out. We're going to sing a hymn and we're going to greet each other, because there's nothing like when a family is all gathered in one place. And it's our desire that all of us as a family will be in one place. But before we sing that very special hymn, on behalf of all of us as elders and pastors, we want to say thanks to, and members too, we want to say thanks to our deacons and our deaconesses
for having made the provision. Come on, somebody. So that we could have such a beautiful communion service. Could you put your hands together for them? Thank you so very much. Thanks to all the elders and Pastor Hazelwood who shared in this special service. We appreciate you. Let us all remain faithful, brethren. Soon we will hear from the lips of our Savior and friend. Well done, thou good and faithful servant. There's a hymn that I love. There's a hymn that I love. And I want us to sing it. Pastor Appiah, I want you to lead this praise team this afternoon with that voice. Amen? And I want my praise team to give back up. And I want all of us to sing as we have never done. Sister Emo, you have played that organ so many times. But I want you to sing. I want you to find something that you've never found before. Amen. But the song says, just over the mountain in that promised land lies that. Come, could we all stand to our feet while we prepare to sing and just celebrate God's goodness and God's forgiveness? Our ushers will be standing at the main exit with the offering plates. Please give a very special offering that will go in aid of community services and outreach. We heard the testimony of our team going down to downtown Brampton to share with the less fortunate. We want to make sure that as a church we can remain relevant as we seek to impact and transform lives for His glory. Are we ready to sing, brethren? Are we ready to sing? We are nearing home. Sing it like you mean it. Come on now. Oh, just over the mountain in the promise. Lies the holy city, come on. Lies the holy city built by God. So, as our weary footsteps, as our way, I know they're getting weary. Hold on, we can view our homeland of it. Come on, church. Come on, just lift your hands and sing. We are nearing home. See the glory, see the splendor gleaming from the dunes afar. Or see the glory streaming through the gates. Very soon, soon we'll enter nevermore. To hear the angels singing, hear the angels singing, we are nearing. We are nearing home.
Ring home.
In the roles of the prophets. In the roles of the prophets, we have long. Of that wondrous city, come on, church. Of that wondrous city with its streets of. Now with ruptured vision. Now with ruptured vision, we can see. With its walls of jasper. With its walls of jasper and its man. Church, if you believe it, won't you sing it? Oh, we are nearing home. Oh, we are nearing home. Oh, see the splendor gleaming from the
dunes afar.
Oh, see the glories streaming through the gates ajar. Oh, there will soon we'll enter nevermore to roam. Hear the angels, hear the angels singing.
We are near, ring home, we are near, ring home.
This last stanza now, this is where we want to embrace somebody. This is where you're going to hug somebody. This is where you're going to say to that brother, my sister, will you meet us there in that land of sunshine where there'll be no care, accept of God's message, and to Him be true. Then when Jesus cometh, He will call. We're going to sing now. We're going to embrace each other. Amen. So just move from where you are as we sing this last stanza. My brother, my sister, will you meet us? Come on, in that land. In that land of
sunshine,
be no care. Praise the Lord, come on.
Accept of God's message and
to Him
be true.
Oh,
that when Jesus
come at the will call. Come on, church. We are nearing home. Sing.
We are nearing.
Oh, we are. Come on, church. Sing that song. Oh, see the splendor gleaming from the domes afar. See the glory streaming to the gates of. Oh, they will soon will enter nevermore. To, come on, church, sing, hear the angels singing. Angels singing, we are nearing home. We are nearing. We are nearing home. We are nearing. Home, we
are nearing home.
See the splendor gleaming. To the gates ajar, they will soon will enter nevermore. To home, the angels singing, we are
near home,
we are near. Let God's people say, praise the Lord. Let God's people say, hallelujah. Let God's people say, thank you, Jesus. We are nearing home. You just remain seated. Praise team. We will continue to sing that very special hymn that we normally sing, our recessional hymn. And we continue to fellowship as the ushers now take up their respective positions. Stay right where you are so that you will be ushered out. Sing the wondrous
love of Jesus, sing his mercy and his grace,
in the
mansion
bright and blessed,
he'll prepare for us a place,
when we all
get to heaven.